item. With pranams at the lotus feet of Bhagavan. Dear friends, I am back. I am glad to be back again to be in your midst to complete the rest of the divine dialogues. Well, I think we have been through at least half of the things that have been covered in Telugu Sanatana Sarathi. And I hope to complete it before Bhagavan leaves this place, so that you will have enough of time to edit and circulate among yourselves. This relates to 1st of January 2002. After the sports meet, Bhagavan started talking to the boys and he gave them some instructions which are of immense value to all of us. For every one of us to follow, Bhagavan took this opportunity to convey his message. What he said was, point one, that it is absolutely necessary for everybody to talk less. Why? By talking more, one loses energy. One loses memory. One is likely to speak lies. One is likely to exaggerate the facts. So in order to avoid these four mistakes of the tongue, Bhagavan wants us to talk less. And further he also went on to say that wrinkles on the face and the old age are also due to too much talk. So all of us wish to be young, you know. So better we follow his caution. Point two, he told boys, remember always ABC. What is the meaning of that? Avoid bad company. Avoid bad company. Tell me your company, I shall tell you what you are. Therefore, we have got to be very careful about the company amongst which we move. And then Swami said that one has to necessarily join the good company and run away from the bad company. As is the company, so you are. As is the company, so you become. Bhagavan said, the sand in the company of air goes up. The very sand in the company of water goes down. Fire in the company of green grass gets extinguished. Spark of fire. The very spark of fire in the company of dry grass will burn anything. Therefore, company, one has to be very careful. Point four, he said, was one should always search for an opportunity, wait for an opportunity to involve in good actions, good deeds. They are very necessary in life. They only speak of our spiritual path. Without doing any good service activity, no one can be spiritual. No one can be religious. Point five. Bhagavan said, better you have less contacts. too many contacts will take us to socialization. Socialization. And that will disturb our state of mind. That will disturb our thinking process. So less contacts, least contacts, so that we can live to ourselves, maintain our own ideology, hold on to our own character, continue our process of thinking, go by our own chosen path of life. For all these benefits, one has to have least contacts. That's what Bhagavan said. Next point, 6. As we mix, as we mingle, see that we don't touch anyone. We don't touch anyone. Because when we touch anyone, those vibrations will reach you. The vibrations of other man will come to you. Therefore, one has to see that he doesn't touch anybody. And by this constant touch with other person, naturally you lose your concentration. That's what Bhagavan said. Point 7. He made it very clear that meditation is possible when you are alone, not in a community, not in a group. Some people want to meditate in that Kulwant hall. Is that possible? Sevadal will ask you to move to the front. Next Sevadal man will ask you to go to the back. The third man will ask you to go to one corner. The other man will ask you to get out. What is it you meditate there? Therefore, meditation is possible when you are all alone, left to yourself. Then Bhagavan also made it very clear, point 8, that one must have this awareness of the divinity which is present in every atom. Atom. Here, Anu, A-N-U. Anu. And this divinity is present in every cell, Kana, K-A-N-A. So, divinity is present in every atom, Anu, is present in every cell, Kana, the cell. That kind of awareness is the true spiritual experience. That's what Bhagavan made it very clear. Then somebody asked Swami, Swami, what is the path towards awareness? What is the path that takes you to awareness? Bhagavan said, there is no path to awareness. There is no path. The experience of awareness is the ultimate. There is no path. If you say that there is any path, it means it involves a time factor. It involves space factor. But the true awareness is beyond time and space. The very experience of awareness is a center, nothing to do with the path, which is related to the time and space. That's what Bhagavan commented. Now, I want to share with you what Bhagavan usually tells us, mostly to students, after sports, every sports meet. As you know, we have annual sports and cultural meet of Sri Satya Sai Educational Institutions. So this applies to 11th of January 2002, which is same as the 11th of January 2003. The message being same. the occasion being same. So the background is annual sports cultural meet. Bhagavan talking to students and staff. So I want to share with you these points. Sports and cultural meet of such institutions is not a routine affair. Every sports meet is unique unto itself. Every sports meet is special. It's not any a matter of a routine or a regular affair. No. Every sports meet is special in its own way. The second point is, such as high education institutions lay emphasis on three areas. One, sports. Two, music. Three, drama. Music, sports, and drama, dramatics. Students are well trained in all these three areas. When students give us any music program, it is of the standard of professionals. I think most of you would agree with me. Orchestra, yes, professional standard. And the same boys are outstanding in the area of sports. And surprisingly enough, these students get O grade in their academics. This is what you call total personality development, where students show excellence in every field, the sports, dramatics, and academics. Point three, usually what happens is people spend a lot of time for preparation. You may not believe if I say students hardly are left with 15 days to prepare for sports meet. If you watch the program, it is unbelievable. Within 15 days of time, they make that kind of presentation. Well, I am not able to believe it. I don't know about you. And you will also know lots and lots of money is spent everywhere. So much of money is spent everywhere for sports. Here, no money is spent. Are you going to believe me? No money is involved. Students make use of the material which is available in the hostel. They make the huge cutouts. They make the backdrops. Everything is done by the students with the material available in the college and hostel. Nothing is purchased. No expenditure. If you calculate from the point of other institutions elsewhere, it would come to lakhs and lakhs of rupees. Nothing. That is very amazing. And usually, sportsmen, athletes outside, they are very good in their field, but with less of discipline in their individual lives. They are outstanding in sports and athletics, but in their individual lives, they are not very much disciplined. But here, all of them are disciplined. In the earlier period of my service here, I could not believe what is happening. Outside, students who are best in sports, they are very weak in academics. For students who are very good in dramatics, they don't attend classes. Students interested in music are not interested in their studies. But here, they are involved in every field, showing excellence. It is nothing but Bhagwan's influence, the impact of Bhagwan on students. And then you will be also noticing outside, if this batch of students are excellent football players, if they leave our college, next year college falls behind in football matches. Is it not? But here batches come and go, but the standard goes on increasing higher and higher. Students may come and go, but standard will go on increasing, because Swami will not compromise so far as standards are concerned. Some of the spectators and some of the dignitaries on the dais, they tell me, look here Anil Kumar, it easily takes 6 months preparation for our students from our place. It is amazing how students make this kind of presentation within 15 days. That's what they say. Now, the question is this. What are the reasons for that stupendous, successful presentation? What are the reasons behind this wonderful performance? If you investigate, you will certainly find some reasons. One, discipline. Discipline of very high standard. Two, their firm determination to accomplish. Firm determination to achieve. And their unflinching devotion to Swami. Devotion. And their spirit of dedication. Above all, the motivation behind this is to make Swami happy. Whatever I do, whether gymnastics or athletics or motorbikes or karate fight, whatever may be, their only motive is to make Swami happy. When Swami is happy, the whole world will be happy. When Swami is not happy, there is no point in making others happy. So that is one point. And if you ask students, what is the incentive? They say, sir, we are doing this not for recognition, not for any medals, not to win trophies, cash awards, newspaper publication, no. We don't want. Just a pat on our back by Bhagavan. Just a photo with him. Just to receive a smile. We'll be happy if Swami says, I am happy. That's all. Nothing whatsoever. This is really something great. Particularly youngsters to have that feeling. Youngsters. Last sports meet, the month of January, in the year 2003, you must have noticed one boy falling from the back of the horse. He fell on the ground. Usually what happens is, the horse will run away, the boy will remain seated, stopping further acts or further performances. But here this boy immediately got up. He started running after the horse and jumped on the back of the horse. Did all stunts as planned before. Jumping over all obstacles. Swami immediately looked at me. I said, Swami, what? All right, let me say, Swami. The boy fell. Oh, I see. He said. Swami ran and sat back on the back of the horse and did all the stunts as per their plan. Good. Notice that. See there. What is happening? That's what Bhagavan said. Usually, it does not happen. And you also must have seen a boy on the back of the motorcycle had hit against the wall, parapet wall, and fell down. The boy on one side, motorcycle on the other side. Nothing had happened to the boy. He immediately got up, picked up the motorcycle, started riding as before. Swami said, see, nothing had happened to him. You know why? They are confident that nothing can happen because Swami is there. Nothing can happen because Swami is there. That's what Swami commented. It's really good. And among the audience, all the spectators there, who are they? They have not come there for entertainment. No. They have not come there on a holiday. They have come there to see Bhagwan and the boys doing so many things there on the playground. Therefore, the discipline and the peaceful atmosphere prevailed on the sports day is not seen anywhere all over the world. You find claps, cheers, shouts, slogans, all disturbances. But here, the whole atmosphere was calm and peaceful, such that the sports and games are also spiritualized. They are also made into a religion. That's something fantastic. You will also notice, or you must have noticed already, a very interesting point. When Vrindavan campus Bangalore boys are on the ground, Prashanthi Nilayam boys equally appreciated their presentation. They cheered, loud applause, whenever there was something fantastic happening on the ground. When Prashanthi Nilayam boys are giving their performance, you find Vrindavan boys enjoying the show. It only means there is no unhealthy rivalry. There is nothing like stupid competition. It's a question of sharing. It's a question of caring. It's a question of display of their talent in front of Bhagwan. This sort of brotherhood among competitors, among students of different campuses participating, a healthy sign, worth emulation by everybody, which is really great. You will also find that it becomes a matter of fun, it's a matter of frolic, where no one wins, no one loses. You must have noticed it. Because Bhagavan gives cups of equal size to everybody. Who stood first? All stood first. Who are second? No one is second to anyone. All are first. Why? It is a presentation by students of every campus. It is a collective effort. It is a cumulative effort. It is not individual effort. No. Therefore, everyone has a role. Every student, those who made cutouts, those who made some frames, those who made some decoration, they are all to be credited for that. We can't say, this man did such a thing. No. So in that aspect, it is really very, very great indeed. And this year you must have seen Prashanthi Nilayam campus boys showing a central globe, very big globe, revolving, held on a very big hand, the palm. Whose is it? It is the palm of Bhagwan Sri Sat Sai Baba. Bhagwan Sri Sat Sai Baba holding the whole globe, which has a message to convey, the creator and the creation. glove is the creation, the hand is the creator. Really, it has drawn the attention of everybody. Now I pass on to the 1st of March 2002. Bhagavan, as usual, came out and was so gracious enough that he asked me to put a question. This is my question. Swami, how is it that all noble good people faced difficulties? Why? All people faced so many problems. Good people faced so many problems in life. Why? Now, Swami, why they had difficulties? Bhagavan's answer is this. They appear to you as difficulties, but to them, they are not difficulties. The noble people, good people, appear to have had difficulties, but to them, they take it as a challenge. They view as if they are put to some test by God, so that they can get through the test successfully. They don't take them as difficulties as you people feel. Kashtalu kadu. They are not difficulties, but they take it as kartavyalu, duties, responsibilities. They view them as kartavya, responsibility, not as kashtamulu, kashtalu, or difficulties. That's what Bhagavan said. Then while talking to boys, Swami suddenly materialized a jewel, what we call Chudamani. Chudamani is a special ornament that ladies put on their head here, which was worn by Sita. And Anjaneya went in search of Sita. And Sita gave that Chudamani to Anjaneya so that Anjaneya could show to Sri Rama as an identification certificate, having seen her. Or else how is he going to accept that he saw Sita? So to make Rama believe that Anjaneya met Sita, Sita gave him the Chudamani she was wearing at that time. Very good piece of this size, full of diamonds. Swami has shown, this is the ornament she wore on the head. Everyone was surprised. Everyone started looking at it. Then, on the dais, there in Kulwant Hall, where you find one lion on each side, with Swami's chair at the center, left to his chair sat the Vice Chancellor, Registrar, Controller of Examinations, some big people. In their company that day happened to be seated another man, a builder, an industrialist of a very big company, Nagarjuna Builders. A very big company. And his name is Raju. Swami was talking to everybody like this. Suddenly, he waved his hand and materialized a fruit of this size. Attipandu, A-T-T-I, meaning it's a wild fig, forest fig, berry. I'm a student of botany, but I'm very ashamed to say I could not identify what it is. And Swami asked me, what is this fruit? I don't know, Swami. Swami said, you are a botanist, don't you know that? I don't know, Swami. Then he said, this is not grown here. This is not available here. So how can you know that? It doesn't grow here. it is brought all the way from elsewhere that you do not know. I see. Good. Supposing if I can't identify which grows here, what will happen to my prestige? That too in front of the students. I have to cut a very sorry figure. So anyhow, a fruit which is not available anywhere around, from a far off place unknown, maybe Himalayas. What do I know? How can I guess? And ask everybody to see that. Holding that fruit on hand, he has cut into two pieces. He gave that half to that Raju, the industrialist. Then I thought, the other half is meant for me. But it did not happen that way. He gave the other half to the vice chancellor. He asked both of them to eat there only. They ate. And this Raju, the builder, said, Swami, and Swami said, how is the fruit? Swami, I visited all pilgrim centers spread all over India. I ate fruits available all over India. This sort of a fruit I have not seen. And the taste of sweetness I cannot express. And he went on describing, it is sweet from here, from navel. Oh. He went on describing the depth of the sweet. How deep it has gone, you know. Very sweet he was telling. And Swami said, you don't find this fruit anywhere. Just I wanted to show it to you. And then Bhagavan turned all around and started telling an episode. There was one lady by name Hemi Reddy Mallamma, a great devotee. She was married to a person who was mad. But many people think that the bridegroom is mad. But truly speaking, he is Shiva himself. And this Hemi Reddy Mallamma is Parvati. Both of them are divine, but they came down in a human form. And everybody considered the husband of this lady lunatic, psychic, but is Lord Shiva. And the mother-in-law of this Mallamma naturally put her to troubles as any mother-in-law would. Well, all troubles. And one day she kept 15 bags of corn to be grinded. 15 bags. They should be grinded in a mortar and be ready by the next morning. What did this lady could do at that time? Next morning, when mother-in-law came, to her utter surprise, all the 15 bags of corn are well grinded. Why and how? It is because of this mad husband who is Shiva in disguise, who is Shankara in disguise. And that's what Bhagavan said. God expresses His divinity in the way He chooses, in the way He prefers. The one whom you call mad is truly speaking God Himself. That is how God manifests. And Bhagavan started in a poetic style. He started speaking to us in a poetic style. Because that Raju builder is a writer. So let him also know that God is also a poet. Not only you, I am also a poet. Then he started speaking. What is real decoration to a village? Decoration to a village is a group of houses constructed there. Being a poet, Swami has chosen special words. grama is a village. For a village, grama, what is the decoration? Griha, the house. So, griha, the house, is a decoration to grama, the village. Full of similes and metaphors. Second, what is the beauty? Where does the beauty of an ocean lie? The beauty of an ocean lies in the raging waves on the surface. Where is the beauty of the sky? The glittering stars of the sky add beauty to the sky. What is the decoration to a peacock? The feathers constitute the decoration of the peacock. He composed a poem and started explaining this. That writer Raju got up and fell at his feet. Swami, what a poet you are. Good, it's all right. You sit down. Because he demonstrates clearly his divinity, that he is a doctor of doctors, when he is in the company of doctors, that he is an engineer of engineers, when he is surrounded by engineers, that he is a scholar and a writer in their company. What not? Because he is a diamond with so many faces. And then, suddenly he looked at a doctor working in a super speciality hospital. Then he said, "What doctor? What happened to that patient?" And doctor said, "Swami, he is fine." "Well, I am very curious to know the details. Swami, what is it interesting here?" Because let everybody hear. Then Swami said, "A patient was admitted in our hospital. He has heart trouble. His lungs are out of order. Above all, he is suffering from cancer, stomach cancer. And such a patient was refused admission by all doctors, naturally. Who will take the risk? And our hospital doctors also said, Swami, this patient is not going to survive. Better we ask him to stay back at home and have a peaceful death." Swami said, "Nothing doing. Admit him in the hospital. Give him the treatment." Doctors have no alternative. So they have to operate on him. It took 8 hours. Bhagavan sat there all through until the operation was over. And then Swami was inquiring about that patient in the very same evening. And doctor tells, "Swami, he is fine." The case of a patient, the hopes of whom are totally given up, started recovering into the unseen hand of Bhagavan Baba. And then Swami made one statement which we should remember. Wherever there is God, there is bound to be victory. There is bound to be success. That's all. So you cannot deny treatment to the patient. This statement implies that Baba is God. When he says wherever is God, there is bound to be success. And second statement, you cannot deny admission to the patient. It's only a revelation to everybody that Bhagavan Baba is God. Then Swami started narrating a small story. What is that story? It seems there was a scholar, a great scholar, and who was utterly poor. He didn't have even a square meal a day. He could not maintain his family. And he was giving discourses on Bhagavad Gita every day in a temple, leading life of helplessness. One day he was so angry with his life. Sometimes we also fall into depression, naturally. We are humans, you know. Sometimes we are frustrated. Life is disappointing at times. Since we are right now here, we get out of that period as early as possible. Had we been at our native places, perhaps we might have needed a psychiatrist. And that period of frustration is less here, being here. So this scholar, who was very, very poor, was very much depressed and frustrated, and out of Gita, he removed one stanza, one canto. What is it? The sloka that says, Ananya Chintayanto Mam, Ye Janah Paryupasate, Tesham Nityabhyuktanam, Yoga Kshemam Vahamyam. That is the text of that sloka. The meaning is, whosoever thinks of me with unwavering faith will be successful. It is my duty to take care of your welfare. That is the meaning of that sloka. This scholar removed that sloka and tore it into pieces. Why? I am thinking of you. I am speaking about you. But I am very poor. You gave a promise that you will take care of me. But you have not taken care of me. So he tore up that sloka. Understandable. Not only he kept quiet at that stage, he took a blade and had cut it across with all the vengeance. And then he went to bed. It was the afternoon time. He was having siesta or afternoon nap. At that time, two boys came. One is very fair, one is little dark. And the scholar's wife received them. And then the scholar's wife said, boys, what do you want? The boy said, Amma, we have come here to pass on two bags of rice. We are commanded to place these two bags of rice here. Let us unload. They unloaded two bags of rice and complained to the wife of this scholar. Look here, mother. Your husband is not a good man. What? He has cut our backs with a blade. See, it is bleeding. Watch. This lady said, no, my husband is not of that type. He is a preacher. He speaks on Gita. He is not violent. He is not of that type. He won't cut anybody's with a blade. He won't do that. No, Amma, please see. That's what your husband did. And so saying, the two boys left. The scholar, after good sound sleep, got up and went in, saw two bags of rice. He called his wife, what? The wife said, it seems two boys were commanded to hand over these two bags of rice. I do not know. Those two boys unloaded them. Oh, good. Who are those two boys? The wife said, why do you ask me that question? The two boys whose backs you have cut with a blade came here. Me cutting with a blade? I never did it. I don't do that. Then the scholar asked, how do they look? What is their age? The wife said, they are two young boys.
One is very fair, one is little dark. Then the scholar could understand. The dark complexioned one was Krishna. The fair complexioned boy was his brother Balarama. Krishna Balarama. One is dark, other is fair. Then immediately he fell at the feet of his wife and said, "How fortunate you are. You could see Krishna and Balarama. Well, I could not all these years. Speaking on Gita, what for? You are really lucky." That story Bhagwan narrated to all of us and said, "Those who seek refuge at the feet of God will never be denied of anything in this world. Will never be poor, because God will take care of them, because they have surrendered to Him totally." And then Bhagwan mentioned two characters. One is from Mahabharata, Bhishma. One is from Ramayana, Vibhishana. Swami said, Vibhishana of Ramayana is greater than Bhishma of Mahabharata. This point is not known to Indians. This point will not be accepted by Hindus. No. Because Bhishma is a senior man. Vibhishana is not that great in archery or in penance or in wisdom. Vibhishana is just a brother of Ravana, an ordinary inhabitant of Lanka. Bhishmacharya is a great man. Baba says Vibhishana is greater than Bhishma. Who will accept it? Now Swami gives another dimension. Bhishma, although a great man, Bhishma, although a great scholar, expert in archery, a man of deep penance, is less than Vibhishana, who is so simple, ordinary. Why? Vibhishana, when once he came to know that his brother Ravana committed a mistake, he immediately attacked him. "Brother, you should not do this. Brother, you should not kidnap the wife of another man. This is wrong. If anyone does same thing to you, would you not feel bad?" So he opposed him. He wanted to teach him a lesson. But elder brother Ravana refused to hear. Then Vibhishana left his company, came out and surrendered to Rama. But Bhishma of Mahabharata, in spite of all his greatness, continued to remain with Kauravas, the brutal fellows. He never left their company. So one may be wise, one may be aged, one may be a scholar, one may be an expert. If they still continue to cooperate and support the wicked people, all will fall into nothingness. You may be simple, you may be humble, you may be ordinary, but if you leave your own kith and kin when they are bad and surrender to God, you are really greater than any powerful man in this world. That's what Bhagavan has said. He gave another episode, Prahalada from Mahabhagavata. He differed with his father. Father Hiranyakashipu had put him to test. He gave him poison. He made elephants to trample over his body. He has put him in fire. But nothing happened to Prahlada. He withstood all the tests. That also Bhagwan made a mention of it. And then Swami gave this example. I want all of you to hear this carefully, because this has got some lesson to learn. You must have heard of King Kong. Yes. King Kong, well-built body. The wrestler. The moment you hear his name King Kong, you can imagine his personality. This King Kong, with his well-built body, with muscles all over, not able to bear his own weight, he always did morning exercises to maintain his body. The body like a huge mountain. And one day, when he was doing physical exercises, a girl happened to pass by that street. He looked at that funny creature, something like a mountain doing like that, with all muscles. This girl laughed, because this King Kong was wearing only shorts. Only muscle, mountain moving like that. This girl laughed. And King Kong was very angry. What? You laugh at me? He was ready to give one or two blows. And then this girl further laughed. She laughed more. Then King Kong said, "What is there to laugh?" And the girl replied, "Sir, you have got so much of muscle power. Why? You could not control your temper. You could not control your anger. Why this body waste? Your body is a waste. Because you could not control your temper. You could not control your anger. Why this body? After all, when a small girl laughs at you, what is it you lose? You don't lose 2 pounds of flesh. Why are you angry?" Then King Kong realized his mistake. This illustration, Baba says, boys, it is not enough if you are physically strong. It is not enough if you are mentally alert. It is more important that you control yourself. It is more important that you have balanced state of mind. That's what he said. And then he turned towards the warden and he said, "Look here, warden, take care of our boys. See that they study well. See that they are healthy and strong. When my boys are happy, I am happy. When boys are happy, Swami is happy." That's what he said. And then he told the wardens, "Our institutions are not for business, are not for profit making. No, 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 no. Don't compare our institutions with the other institutions. No. We are quite different. I don't want you to make any profit. I don't want you to make any business. I want you to see that our boys are strong. Our boys are healthy. That's very important. And our boys should learn values more than the education. It is for that purpose I started these institutions." That's what Swami said. And then, suddenly, one gentleman, a professor, he just got up and said something to Swami. "Swami, this had happened, Swami, this had happened." He was telling something, what had happened. Swami immediately turned round and said, "I know, why do you tell me? Where am I? Where am I? I know everything." Then I was thinking within myself, "How do you know?" I did not open my mouth, because I know it involves a risk. How do you know? Then Baba said, without
this question being put to him, he said, who taught swimming to fish? No one need to tell me or teach me. I know everything, he said. I know everything. That's how my doubt within is neatly answered without telling. That's all for the day. And, yes. I think I covered all. And we'll continue the next session. Okay? So we have completed the January 2002, February 2002, and March 2002. We'll carry the rest in the next session. Thank you very much.